Nityananda namastubhyam premananda pradayine karukarmasana sayam janamapataye namah adadana srinam tam teridam yache puna puna shri bhutam padam bhutadhi shyam chanya dharmani radhe vrindavana dishe karunamrita vahine kripaya nija padam sha dasyam mayam pradiyatam chanakya jada yatro niraso navjaneto vigavara varavaro marati kundamal tarara tarunavesho nirapitam varesho na nipunje radhika krishna chande shri krishna chaitanya prabhu nityananda shri advaita gadadhar shivasari gaura bhakta vrinda hare krishna hare krishna 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 hare 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 rama hare rama 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 hare hare. So first of all, I offer my unlimited dandavat pranams in the lotus feet of my spiritual masters Nitya Lila Prabhishna Vishnupad, Shishrima, Chira Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj, Shira Prabhupada. Nitya Lila Prabhishna Vishnupad, Shishrima, Chira Gaurgopinath Swami Maharaj. Nitya Lila Prabhishna Vishnupad, Shishrima, Chira Bhaktivedanta Narayan Goswami Maharaj. Nitya Lila Prabhishna Vishnupad, Shishrima, Chira Bhaktirakshat, Chira Goswami Maharaj. Paru Paru Garu Vagya, Vaishnava Chara, Janam Vaishnava Chara. Headed by Shripad. All Prabhupada disciples are there. Are you also?
Kind of, in Mumbai.
Yeah. Okay. So, before we meet with Krishna, then there is a process which will give us a very big desire to meet with Krishna, because without some type of separation there will be no possibility to meet Krishna beforehand. So all our Guru Vagya, that means all our Vaishnava precedents, Vaishnavas, our sages from the past, and especially Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, they demonstrate that before union with God, then there must be separation. Mood is there. So, when we feel separation, that means we need something which we don't have. The value of something is according to the need. Like I said yesterday, one general was dying, one king was dying on the battlefield in Kurukshetra, and then for 3 days he was wanting to have some water, otherwise he would die. Then somebody came and said, I give you one glass of water, but or one condition, that you give me your kingdom. He said, yes, I give you my kingdom, because what's the use of a kingdom if I die? And if I survive, then I will make another kingdom. I'm king, so no problem. So the value of something is how much we need. You know? So Mahaprabhu, by taking sannyas, he threw the whole of his village and followers into a ocean of separation. He never said anyone to anything to anyone. He just influenced, how you say, he just influenced all his followers the day before he was going to take sannyas to come and meet him. Yeah. So they all came. It was the day of Lakshmi Puja, a very, very nice festival where everybody exchanges gifts. So all brought something and gave garlands to Mahaprabhu. And he took the same garland and gave it to them. And he advised all his followers that we should only chant the name of Krishna while we walk, while we sit, while we eat, while we sleep. Whatever we do, we should only chant the name of Krishna and do nothing else. So then the next day he left for Katwa by going through Ganges near Bagat, and then he walked for 21 miles, something like that, long distance. Then he went there to take sannyas. And already he was in the mood of willing to chant 24 hours a day. He thought, if I take sannyas, I have no more responsibility with society. Yeah. But we all belong to Varnashram Dharma. In different stages, everybody has a place according to his nature and his works in Varnashram Dharma. But sannyas means he's in Varnashram Dharma, but he is going out of Varnashram Dharma. So he took sannyas, and then he was thinking, I will go to Vrindavan. That's the place where Krishna's prominence is available, and I will be influenced and inspired by Krishna's Tirtha, where he has performed his pastime, and I will be inspired and I will chant 24 hours a day. So he took sannyas, then as he received all the mantra and the names, Krishna Chaitanya, then he ran towards Vrindavan.
Maharaj, could you change the Sanskrit words and give them translation in English? Because some people don't know, like sannyas, you can say the renounce order of life, Varnashram Dharma, division of society, just so people understand. There's some Sanskrit words, yeah.
Okay.
Difficult to follow the thread otherwise, missing one word.
So, can I have a glass of water? Because I feel like
The chaunts, I think Yashashmi is making a chaunts.
A chaunts,
it sounds feels like it.
Frying spices.
Huh?
Frying spices in the kitchen.
Yeah. So, Mahaprabhu willing to go to Vrindavan, then he was running towards west, but as he was completely absorbed in the mood of separation from Krishna, then he didn't know what to do. He didn't know whether he was going north, west, south, east. He was just running blindly any place. Then Nityananda, Chandrasekhar, Gadadhar Pandit, they were following him, trying to catch on him, not to lose him. But sometimes was possible, sometimes not, because he was completely unaware of the external world, being completely absorbed. Because absorption is one of the principles which a devotee who is meditating on his Lord, he has acquired, you know. Because Lord is not from this world, and then in order to get in touch with him, we have to go very deep to be aloof from the influence of the senses. Actually, when we chant Hare Krishna, just a parenthesis,
bracket.
When we chant, our senses should be closed down, you know? Because as long as the senses are working, then there will be always some busyness to analyze, to read the world around us. Then our mind will be busy looking at the things behind around us, and the absorption will not take place. That's why Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur said, when we chant, we should not look at the picture. Yeah, I was surprised also. But because when you look at the picture, the senses, external senses, which have no power to contact the Supreme Personality of God, then they will be busy analyzing, looking, and That's why Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur always said that to take the darshan, to look at the Lord when we go in the temple room, we should not try to see. Because we are not able to see him. You know, we see the deity, we think we are seeing Krishna, but we are not seeing Krishna. We see only, what do we see when we take darshan of the deity?
Beautiful, the deity seems to reciprocate if you, depending on how you are feeling towards the deity, the deity looks different every day. I mean, rather London Ishvara, every time I see them, depending on what kind of consciousness I'm in, they kind of, they seem different.
So it's very important to understand that the deity is a person, and we are not seeing the person, we see only the statue. Yes. You say no, but I say yes. I'm not saying yes. All acharyas, they say, you cannot see the deity. You say, oh, deity is so beautiful today. How do we know the beauty of the deity if we cannot see it?
It's different levels.
Levels and levels. But before you achieve the level of seeing the deity, then many millions of lifetimes can pass. It's not so easy, though. Yeah, I tell you a story. One time, one devotee was worshipping Lord Krishna. And for many, many months, maybe 2 years, he was offering incense, everything. At the same time, he had some desires to fulfill. So he was asking the Lord, please help me to fulfill my desires. But he was worshipping very nicely. But after 2 years, nothing happened. Not of his, any of his desires were fulfilled. And he was praying, please, to the deity, Thakurji. But nothing happened. One morning he decided, this is enough now. I'm fed up with this Krishna. I will change the deity today. Then he went to the Multiwala. I don't know, where, in Jaipur maybe. Then he came back with a deity of Kali. Because he knows Kali will fulfill all my desires. So he installed Kali deity, and he put Krishna from one side to another side in the same room. Then he was taking an incense and about to lit up the incense to offer to Kali. But then he thought, wow, if I lit up this incense, the fragrance will go all over the room. Because incense is not only for one person, it's for everybody in the room. Everybody will get the perfume, the fragrance. So he thought, then this incense will go to this Krishna. And I don't want that he should get any gratification. He has not been nice with me, therefore I will deprive him of this benefit. And he was thinking how to do that. Then he remembered, I have coton hydrophile. Cotton. You know cotton? Then he made 2 balls and he came near to Krishna and to put it in his nostril. And just as he was doing this, Krishna stopped him and said, today I am very happy with the way that you are worshipping. Because for the first time in 2 years, for the first time you think I am a person. You were offering me so many prayers, thus I'm adding this. You offer prayers to a deity not thinking it's a person. And then the deity not being a person, it's like a marble statue or anything like that, brass. And then how can a marble statue or brass statue can fulfill your desire? Not possible. So everything is according to the state of consciousness. You know? If your consciousness is transcendental, then you will see the transcendental form of the Lord. Then you can speak to that form, and then you can have a relationship. Yeah. So Krishna told him, you put me back on the altar, and from now on, you worship me like this, and I will fulfill your desires. You know? Very easy process. Yeah? But you have to think about it. So one time, you know, there was Darshan, and Srila Bhaktisiddhanta was there, but he was very far away from the deities. And one gentleman...
Where is it, Dad?
Well, one gentleman...
Round the corner.
Round the corner.
What's happening? Incense going.
Sorry, sorry. For everyone.
Okay. And one gentleman, he asked Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Bhakti Thakur, he said, please, come on in front of the deity that you can see them. And Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati he said, where I am, the deity are seeing me. This is the most important thing. I don't need to see them. I have no eyes to see them. You know, with my material eyes, I cannot see the deities. But the deity can see me. And this is the most important thing. And Srila Prabhupada, in many places in his books, he said the same thing also. He's a disciple of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta. Why he should say something different? To see the deity is not possible on our stage right now. We see a statue. But because our mind is really, you know, so much moving here and there, we think, oh, the deity is beautiful. But actually, we cannot see the beauty of the deity. The deity is playing flutes. Could you hear the flute playing of the deities? Sweet sound of the flute? Can you see Krishna's, how we say, sidelong glance? Looking towards Radharani, can you see the deities dancing, sometimes laughing and sometimes joking? Nothing. We cannot see this. Therefore, Srila Bhakti Rakshakshidama said we shouldn't impose sight on the seer. The one who sees, we shouldn't impose sight. You follow? No? I know. So what did I say? I said that we shouldn't impose the
sight
on the seer. That he is to be seen, but we are not able to see. He is the one who sees us. You understand? You shouldn't say, I am seeing him. Because we cannot see him. He is seeing us. It's called subjective consciousness. This is another point now. Subjective consciousness. That is the one who is the doer. He is a super subject. In his world, he is a central figure. Absolute center of everything. And everything goes according to his sweet will. This is God. We cannot change his rules by which he is doing things. He manufactures all the rules. Because laws is for everybody, it's not for one person. If there's only one person, no need of laws. So he is the one who manufactures the laws for us, but he's not under the law. So he's above everything, he does what he wants. Therefore, we should be able to understand how Krishna works, and this is called subjective consciousness. Now, by our senses, we are looking things. This is called objective consciousness. Objective consciousness, we are looking at the things that our senses are able to define, and about able to think about, and not so much actually. We are so proud of our senses, but what can we do with those senses? Not so much, you know. Even if you analyze matter, you know, what do we understand about matter? What do we understand about when you look at matter? You see some color, you see some touch. Some texture. Hardness,
texture.
Hardness, texture. and some smart fragrance maybe. That's all we know about matter. It's not so much, you know. So our senses are very weak. So we should not rely on those things in order to make progress in spiritual life. And those who I have told yesterday try to understand God by their intelligence. Those are the ones who are the most cheated by their intelligence. So that kind of knowledge, trying to find out what is God by your own intellectual faculties, mental faculties, sensory faculties, this is a very dangerous process. Because those faculties are very, very limited to a certain dimension, third dimension. This dimension is third dimension, no? And mathematics little bit going towards in the fourth dimension. But there is fourth and fifth, you know, how do we go through these things? By material accessories? Never, not possible. So Krishna is in the fifth dimension, fourth and fifth, and we have no access. So we can only hope that he will look at us. And when we understand he is looking at me, then we understand what is he seeing when he looks at me. Now I look at somebody, but I am not God. He is God, he looks at somebody, he sees everything. Like a scanner, you know. He sees millions of lives before, millions of lives in the future. He sees how much lust, how much greed, how much anger is there, how much craziness, madness, how much envy. He sees everything. So therefore, when we adopt this medium to take darshan, then we become humble. Because there is nothing to be proud of when you come with the big luggage of your past sinful activities in front of the Lord. You know, and when you say, oh, Lord is very beautiful, you know, look at your heart. So dirty, how can you see something beautiful with a dirty heart? I'm talking about myself, don't worry. You cannot see something with a dirty heart. Heart is like a mirror. If it's full of dirt, you cannot see any reflection there. What is reflected in our mind is only the material energy. And our life is, how you say, concentrate on that, what is reflected in our heart. Therefore, Chetodapanamanjana, the process of chanting the holy name to cleanse the heart, will be very useful in order to understand what is the instructions, transcendental instruction, which reflects in our heart when we receive them from a transcendental personality. If the heart is full of dirt, then faith will never take birth in that heart. Never, never. And faith is the fundamental fundamental stage, the first stage where the process of loving devotional takes place. When faith is there, this is the qualification to serve the Lord. You know? So therefore, a spiritual master will not instruct somebody who has no faith. He knows it is useless, because he will not be able to follow the instruction. I give you an example, myself. I was in Bali, and I wanted to speak to Sri Narayan Maharaj. He knew that when I, you know, rodeo a tour, hovering around his room, and I need to speak to him, you know. So he saw me, then he said, come. Then I came, sit down, what do you want? I said, Gurudev, from today I'd like to chant 64 rounds. He said, how many rounds you chant? I said, 32. He said, this is good. Just chant 32 rounds. Read 1 hour a day and learn shoks and prayers 1 hour a day. Very good. Then, coming back to the main thing, Dorni. Or just now, go to the room. I'm coming in a few minutes. You start the kirtan. And you know I'm not such a good kirtanier. And especially at that time, I didn't know much about kirtans. So I went to the temple room. I saw nobody was there. I felt really bad. Said, where are the devotees? Could they have come in 3 minutes and nobody is there? So instead of starting the kirtan that everybody will hear and come, I start to look at the devotees, trying to dispatch the instruction to them, you know, to tell them, hey, Gurudev wants you to start the kirtan, which was not the instruction. The instruction was, I should start the kirtan. So I found a few devotees. By the time we came back, after I found 10 minutes looking for the devotees, then Gurudev was sitting already in the temple room. And when he saw me, he said, I knew you couldn't do it. I knew. I knew you couldn't do it. Because what? No faith. No faith. I don't have the faith that his instruction can be taken to heart and followed with success. Like Prabhupada said, if I have succeeded in my mission to spread Krishna consciousness, because I followed the instruction of my spiritual master. And that instruction can go very, very far. It's a very powerful instruction. You know Shivji, one king in India? Not Lord Shivji, Lord Shiva. Shivji was a king in India. He had a spiritual man, a very, very famous king, very, very strong, powerful, opulent also. And he had a spiritual master which gave him once the instruction of milking a tigress and taking the milk of a tigress in a golden bowl. And he gave this instruction to him. That's heard about this?
Yeah, sounds like a real challenge. Huh? It sounds like a real challenge.
Yeah. So the king, you know, usually the king, you know, they are very attached to their life because they have such a position. They would not, you know, like I just read this morning, Obama is not going to leave his position in America. He's going to suspend the elections.
Oh,
yeah, he's such a person. He can do it, but we'll see. I don't want to. I don't want to go into politics. Anyway, so he went with a golden ball, and then he saw a tigress in the jungle. She was giving milk to the little cubs. So he was like wondering. Then he was a few steps ahead, then he stopped. Then tigress heard the grass, you know, cracking, the dry leaves. She opened her eyes and looked at him. And then closed her eyes. The baby were taking them in. She didn't do anything. Then slowly, slowly he approached the tigress, and he took the milk. And he filled up the bowl, and then he left. Oh. This is the power of Guru instruction. Because who is Guru? It's Krishna himself. Talking through a person about himself. Guru is Krishna talking about himself through another person. Like somebody who is massaging his own legs. Like this. Guru would say, you have to serve Krishna. And Krishna is telling through Guru, you have to serve me. So it's the same thing. When Guru gives instruction, Krishna is giving instructions. So Krishna is in the heart of living all living entities. If you can tell this person or this living entity, don't do anything, then it will not happen. Living entity will not do anything. Like in the case of Haridas Thakur, his followers were coming to take darshan every day. Here is Harikatha. But once they said, the place where you live, this cave, there's a very, very venomous, big, black snake. And we are very afraid. The snake is moving behind you, you don't see. But we are coming and we look. And this snake seems to be very dangerous. So they ask Haridas Thakur, please, you move to another place. And Haridas Thakur was about to move. And then the snake came and strolling on the side, and then he disappeared, never to be seen again. So Krishna is in the heart of everyone, and he can command, do this, don't do this. You know, like this. Like, there was another example, I just lost it. Anyway. So faith That's the most important thing. Our spiritual life starts with that unit of faith, which is there in the heart. Although it might be immature yet, not ripened to give the fruit of our sadhana process, going up to prema. But it is the beginning. It's like you, if you have a mango, a good fruit, but it is green and ripe. You could say this is the beginning of a fruit which will take up for a process of ripening through the stages of time, then lights, then moonbeams, wind, flower, water, sorry. Then at one point, after some time, the fruit will become ripe and mature. Then it will be ready for consumption. But before that, the same fruit, it is the same fruit, but it is not ripened yet. So our process is like that. Beginning of the process is to have faith. This is unripened fruit. Then sadhu sangha, vajana kriya, different stages, progressing towards the goal of prem. Then through the stages, the fruit is ripening, and then when it becomes mature, then you can take it. This is prem. So faith, in the beginning is called shraddha, faith, and at the end it's called love. So, how to look at the deity? When we understand the deity is looking at us and seeing everything, and that everything is an object of pleasure of that deity, meant for his exclusive satisfaction to be offered to him, then this is the beginning of darshan, taking darshan. If you just say, "Oh Lord, so nice, so beautiful." No. It's like looking at another object of the matter of the senses. It's offensive to see the deity with these eyes and thinking the deity is like this, like that. It's not good. Because we do the same thing with a woman who seen her in the street. "Oh, look good. Oh, this guy is so nice." You know, like this. "Oh, the deity is so good, so nice," you know? We cannot make Krishna equal to any object of this world. You know, there's a world of difference. And if we don't know the difference, then we cannot make progress. We cannot lift ourselves and take off from this matter, material places, and make progress towards the goal. So it's important to technically understand how everything works. What is Krishna's nature? How Krishna works? If I tell Krishna, "Oh, I've been chanting for the last 40 years, please now, you please appear in front of me." You give instruction to Krishna. Thus Krishna will appear? Huh? You know this expression, "all right reserved," you know, all right reserves. You cannot force Krishna to do anything. He's independent, completely. His will is the law. He can say, "This is the way." And then the next moment he can say, "No, it will be different. It will be like this." And you cannot do anything about it. You cannot do anything. If Krishna says it is like this, you have to say, "Yes, it is like this." Then he said, "No, it is not like this. It is like that." You have to say, "Yes, it is like that." You know? Like one time, one spiritual master was telling his devotee, his disciple, "Oh, this is a rope. Or this is a snake." The disciple says, "No, Gurudev, this is a rope." Then Guru said, "No, it is a snake." Disciple said, "No, it is a rope. Gurudev, come on. It's not a snake, it's a rope." Gurudev said, "Don't you have eyes to know what it is? Why you argue with me? Why are you forcing your mind upon my you know, telling you something. Why you want to be above, you know, the law? Yeah? Like this. Like one time, Krishna and Arjuna was walking somewhere, and Krishna, he saw an elephant, and he told Arjuna, "Did you see this beautiful horse there?" And Arjuna looked and said, "Oh yes, nice horse." Then he saw a peacock, and he said, "Did you see this crow there?" Arjuna said, "Oh yeah, the crow is there." Then Krishna said, "Why you say the horse is an, the elephant is a horse, and the peacock is a crow? Why do you say like this?" And Arjuna said, "My Lord, I see through your eyes. You can't change a horse into an elephant into a horse like this. You can change a peacock into a crow and a crow into a peacock. There's no limitation to your powers. So if you see, if you say this elephant is a horse, then it must be, you know, because the next moment can be a horse, you know."
When you call that subjective reality.
Huh?
When you call that subjective reality.
Subjective reality, yeah. You have to see according to Krishna's point of view. Then you start to see things as they are. Because if we use these senses, then you're going to be cheated like anything. All your life, day after day after day. Life after life. So subjective consciousness. Krishna is a super subject. So he is the one who decides. He's above everything. Is the cause of all causes. So we should see according to this. And we should see also that all objects of this world, they're meant for his satisfaction. And we are also one of those objects. We should not think we're separate. We belong to the, how you call it, paraphernalia of Krishna's enjoyment. We belong to it. We have no choice. Like if you say, "Oh Krishna, I give myself to you," he could say, "Why are you saying like this, liar? You belong to me. How can you say I give myself to you? By constitution, you belong to me. What you talking about?" Yeah. You may say, "I don't want to surrender. That's better." But if you say, I give myself to you," then Krishna will say, "Okay, we'll see. Let's try. But you already belong to me." And, you know, because of this type of mentality that people have, it's very difficult that Krishna will manifest himself in one's heart. Because we say, "I give myself to you. Oh Gurudev, I give everything I have to you. You are my father. You are my well-wisher. I give you my house. I give you my possessions. I give you all my money, but I keep the key with me." This is not good. You see? "I keep the key with me. I give you everything, but I keep the key." So, we have to like be subject to this understanding, you know, that Krishna is like absolute autocrat. Autocrat? What do you mean?
Autocrat.
That he decides for himself what is to be done or not. Like, if he wants to say that, "Oh, I want that you should come next, close to me," then how happy we will become, you know? But if we say, if he says that, "I don't have any thing to do with you," if he tells you like that, "I don't want to have anything to do with you," then where you are? Nowhere. Huh? Therefore, this prayer, you do Omar. How does it mean? Do Omar. Mar means Mar, M-A-R-R. Hmm. It's an English word.
There's N-A-R, which means to spoil.
Spoil?
I don't know about two R's.
Do Omar. That means, you know. Anyway, Asli Shava Padaratam, this is the same type of understanding, that you can do whatever you like with me, or you can reject me. You have total freedom to do whatever you like. You all will be remaining the eternal object of my worship. Even by rejecting me, if I, you know this translation better than me, you know, I'm translating from French, but if you reject me, and by doing so, I feel much, much pain. But if I feel that that pain is giving you pleasure, this is my greatest pleasure. You know, people, they praise in this way, they pray, you know. But if you analyze their prayers, it doesn't come anything near to this one. Asti shava padaratam pinashtu mama darshanam marmahatau karotuva yata 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 lampato matrana natustu natastu saivana paratya. That you do what you like. If you reject me, then I have no one to go to. Then I have to come back to you, you know, like the child. When the mother chastises the child, the first reaction of the child, he will embrace the mother and cry. But he will not go away. So we have to be like this. To say yes to everything Krishna wants. This is called surrender. You know, there was a king, he was looking for a sycophant. You know sycophant?
Sycophant.
A sycophant. Means somebody who's yes man. You know. Then he told, there's 3 persons came for the job. Then he said the first one, are you qualified for the job? The first one said, yeah, I am very qualified. So the king said, I think you are qualified. The other person said, yes, I am qualified. Then the king said, I'm not sure whether you qualify or not now. Something comes, I see something, maybe you're not qualified. And the person says, yes, yes, I am qualified. So the king said, okay, let's see. Second, then same thing happened. Then the third one came and said, king said the same thing, you are qualified? Yes. I'm not sure whether you're qualified or not. And the person said, also, I'm not sure. I think you're not qualified. The person said, yes, sir, I'm not qualified. Okay, I take you. Because you completely goes with my ideas. You know? So, this is called union with Krishna. You have to go with his ideas. Huh? This is what's called devotional service. You do what Krishna thinks, what Krishna wants, and then you are with Krishna always. Huh? So our activity is to fulfill Krishna's desires. We want to fulfill Krishna's desires. So in order to know what desires he has, then you approach his pure devotee who knows him. Therefore, the spiritual master is, you cannot avoid. Spiritual master knows Krishna, is a friend of Krishna, is a beloved of Krishna. He knows every of Krishna's desires. Then he can give us instruction on how to give pleasure to Krishna. According to this verse, you know, Anya Bilasita Sunyam, Yana Karma Dhyana Vitama Nukuryena Krishna Nukshinara Bhakti Vitama. So then if we start doing this, then it's called, you know, darshan. We get the darshan of the Lord slowly, 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 you know. And we should think that Lord's feet is like the sun above our head. The sun sees everything in this world. He can light the whole world. He's everywhere. So just like a sun, the Krishna's lotus feet, we should think they're above my head, like in the sky, and they can see me everywhere. So Krishna is always watching me. What is he doing? What is he not doing? What kind of like this? And if we remember this, then we see how Lord will come in the heart, and then we will be able to lighting up our heart and see what is there. How we can serve him from the core of our heart. Because we need vision, like Arjuna need vision to see a universal form. So we need vision to see what's in our heart, because if you look like this, you will not see anything. So So this vision is coming from Krishna's energy. And by this vision, you will know whether you do something right or not. Like sometime I saw that there was a group of communication. They came and they taught something, you know, to devotees, and I was not really inspired to follow, but I went there.
I was there, I remember.
Yeah? Where?
In South of France.
No.
No?
I was in India.
Oh, sorry.
Anyway, I was really thinking, am I doing the right thing or not? Then I saw that those who follow this, it can be compared to the gops who went into the mouth of this Agasura. They thought, this is a new playground. Let's go inside. And they had faith that they will play and do this and that. So they entered. And what happened? This Agasura closed his mouth and they all felt fainted and conscious. I thought, if I follow this, it will happen, the same thing will happen to me. I'm not going to do it. But I did it to see. And finally, you know, I couldn't get any good things about it, really. But so many nice things. But I don't want to talk about this. But the point is that we have to see according to Krishna's vision. Then when we adopt this same vision, then we can navigate everywhere. So the spiritual world, everything is working according to this. The heart is one with Krishna desires. The heart is one. Ragatmika means raga is in the atma, atmik. You know, ragatmika? All in the spiritual world is called ragatmika jhan. Those are all ragatmika. Raga means ishte surasika raga. Raga. What's the first? You know everywhere. Not this one. That it will that this raga, this love for Krishna, will produce a complete absorption, intense absorption in the worship of the object of our love and affection. Total absorption. So this raga is there in the heart of the eternal residence of the spiritual mind, the spiritual world. Atmika means it is in the Atma. Like, you know, if you have a color on one glass, you know, then you can scrub, then the color will go away. But if the glass is made mixing with the color from the beginning, then you can scrub as much as you like, it will not go, because it is mixed. So their love for Krishna is mixed with their art. So their art is actually a producer of love, producing love and affection. So whatever they say, even without thinking about what they say, it's full of love and affection. So there cannot be any mistake. As we use our senses to say and think about things in this world, and because there's no connection with the heart, then it's always a mistake. Like Harishchandra, he was saying, I am king, I'm this, I'm that. I am truthful, I never said a lie. And Vishwamitra has proved the other way around. But you are a liar, you are not king, you have no child, your queen is not yours anymore, and you lost your kingdom. All the things you knew and you had faith in that were completely wrong. So you should do proper way of practicing sadhana in order to achieve the truth, absolute truth. So absorption must be there. And intensity. Samudkanta and absorption. Who knows? Ashabanda, Sabutkanta, not Ashabanda. Samutkanta is there. Anyway, I forgot the Sanskrit terms. But those two things must be there. So the spiritual inhabitants, they have this raga in the heart. So there's no way that anybody can fall from the spiritual world. No possible. Because this raga is like a piece of metal, and Krishna is like a magnet. So how piece of metal can escape the power of the magnet? It goes like this. How can you save yourself from that? No possible. So how can you fall from the magnet of Krishna's beauty, Krishna's, you know, charming personality, sweetness, personification of ecstasy and ananda, happiness? How can you escape this beauty and love? Not possible. In the spiritual world, everybody is a slave of God. Slave is not a good word, but in this case, it is very good.
A willing slave.
Slave.
A willing slave.
Willing. Everybody wants to be the slave of Krishna, because Krishna is beauty and love, so they are slave of beauty and love. Because love has the power to control everything. You know, love controls everything. If somebody loves you, then you will say, yes, what do you want? What should I do for you to please you? Like this, you know. If you love somebody, you're ready to. And beauty, oh, can control everything also. Somebody beautiful, everybody is running after. You are a beautiful person in this country? Sean Connery. James Bond.
You've been off the scene a long time.
A long time. No, I'm telling you, I don't know who's who. You know, we have Brigitte Bardot, but now she's...
Well, that's really ancient.
Lady Diana.
Diana, yeah. Miss Universe, as beautiful as Miss Universe.
Bridget's an old girl now.
One time I was distributing books in Berlin, huh?
Bridget is an old girl now.
Yeah, she's older than you, man. I always want to meet her, but now it's too late, I never met her. Now if I would meet her, I would not go. I saw the picture, it's enough. You know, sometimes when I have beard, people say, you look like Sean Connery. I don't know why they say like this, but two times a year it happens. So one time I was distributing books in Berlin, and my books, you know, and one lady came and said to me, are you Sean Connery? Shocked. I knew that sometimes they say like that. Especially when I have hair and beard. I said, yes. Then she said to me, I have seen all your films. I said, thank you. No. Have you read my books? She said, no. I said, no, I have all of them here. I give it to you, you give me a donation. And she went for it, and she gave me a donation, I gave her a pile of books. She said, I will read them. Yeah. No, I mean, you know, Gurudev one time he told me there's nothing Gurudev can tell to his disciples in order to make him progress. Nothing he will not tell. Even he would tell lies. You know, Krishna's telling so many lies. That's why he call him Dut, liar. Shyam means a liar. Shyam means I am liar. So lying is not a bad thing when it's helping you to make progress. Huh? Like one time, they were building this Bombay temple, Jew Beach. And the Indians were cheating. Normally, if Indians are not cheating, they're not Indian. So they were cheating.
That's true. Huh?
But they were in India, though, they were cheating. Then devotees complained to Prabhupada. They say, oh, Prabhupada, Indians are cheating us. He said, I am Indian, and I am also cheating you. I tell you, chant Hare Krishna, your life will be sublime. And you believe me. He because before your life becomes sublime, you have to go through a lot of, you know, but it will become, you know, no problem if you like a little bit, goes through some challenge in the meanwhile, doesn't matter, because at the end, it will be like that, sublime. So devotee don't mind about, you know, because we have made a pact with Maya in this world. Very, very big connection. Like if you make connection with the mafia, you know?
Maya illusion.
Yeah, Maya illusion. If you make connection with mafia, then when you decide to become honest, then you tell them, okay, I have nothing to do with you anymore. What they say? They say, no possible. You cannot go like that. You know everything about us. We will not let you go. Then you are in trouble, you know? So in the same way, Maya is like that. We made alliance with the dacoits in this world. We made alliance with the dacoits. And now we want to say, oh, dacoits, I want not to see you anymore, the gangsters. I don't want to have anything to do. I am an honest person. They will say, yes, sure, I'm honest. I can see you are so honest, you know? And Krishna says, you know, I am God to the gopis. And they said, oh yeah, really? You were stealing the garments of the gopis. You were stealing butter. God steal butter? We never heard God can steal butter.
What's a gopi?
Gopis means damsels of Vrindavan, one lady.
Okay.
Who is very, very much loved by Krishna. All right. And they don't know that he is God. And he doesn't remember also, because he is very busy doing other things. You know, sometimes it's possible. Yeah. Like the president of a nation, he can do something for a small boy. You know, like come down to the level of a small boy in a precarious position, and he can just play the role of a friend, as if he was nobody, such a big personality. And for a little time he forgets his president's position. So God is like this. He forgets his position due to the intense loving affection of his devotees. They want to see him like son, they want to see him like beloved, they want to see him like friend. So if he doesn't reciprocate, then it's not, the relationship cannot take place. So he forgets.
Yeah.
But he doesn't forget by forcing himself or telling himself, I have to forget that I'm God. No, it is a natural thing. It's difficult to understand, but it is there.
So you're saying he loses himself in pleasure in that instance.
He's still God. Huh?
Yeah.
But he doesn't play as if he was God. Okay. But he doesn't lose any of his divinity quality. You understand?
The power of love, isn't it? The power of pure love.
He comes from the highest, you know, position in his organization there, in the sphere of his organization. He is on top, you know, of the pyramid. Then he comes down amongst us, and he mixes in such a way that we cannot see any difference between him and us. He plays the role of an ordinary person. And everybody thinks he's an ordinary person. So sometimes he jokes with them. He said, do you know I am God? And they say, ha ha, how possible? You are stealing butter when you were a young child. God steals butter. Huh? You are doing this, doing the, so many naughty things, you know. It is called Naravat Lila, the pastimes of an ordinary person, like ordinary person. He's not ordinary, but he plays as if he was ordinary. Then it becomes very, very amazing. Very amazing to see God playing like an ordinary person. You think it is limited? Never. It is completely unlimited also, because he is very, very smart, and he does things which are very wonderful. the way he speaks, the way it looks at you, the way he does things. Looks ordinary, but it's perfect. And you think, oh, he is just a wonderful person.